fängst an, wenn du möchtest, ja.
All right, so welcome back from our spontaneous coffee break. And next up, we got Ingo. And Ingo's going to show us something about A-B testing and some tips and tricks and why we should all do it, right?
Yes, thank you.
So
keep it up. So just for me to know you as the audience, who of you have done a real A-B test on the web already? Okay, of those who has learned something from the A-B test. Okay, and of those who's learned something from the A-B test, does know about the chi-square distribution, this formula here. Huh? Anyone? No. Okay. But that's the only math I will show you a bit more, but not that complicated. Yes, that's me. I'm doing Type of Read since 2003. I'm chairman of the Business Control Committee, chairman of the Type of Read user group in Essen. We are organizing the camp. Yes, and all sorts of stuff. What's special about me? I've got a lifetime Photoshop ban. I was starting with Photoshop in our company, and I was not allowed to do it anymore. And none of my computers is Photoshop right now. I'm working at Marketing Factory. We are a full-service internet agency. We are developing main digital applications located in Düsseldorf, and we are 25 MPAs. And we are looking for companies in mid-sized business so to do their digital solutions. Here there are some. If my clicker is working, yes. When not working, I'm doing like something like that. That's sailing. That's dinghy race sailing. And it's when it's windy, I'm getting really, really wet. And actually, sailing was the first time I got in contact with A-B test. And just I want to explain you how that works there and what we can learn from it in the first time. So when you sail, the goal is, as in any race, to be the first. So the first one to go around this buoy is your goal. And as you can't sail straight against the winds, you have to take a way in an angle, you have to go this way, do a tack, and then sail back to the first buoy, to the first mark. And you can do this on different ways. You can do this on the right-hand side, and you can do this on the left-hand side. So both ways are allowed. You can do both ways. And yes, the question is, I want to be the first one. Which one is the better side? That's an A-B test for me. Left-hand side, right-hand side, where should I go? And normal stuff is that you team up with your colleague. You have got two boats. You start at the same time. You sail. You do a tack. And then somebody should be the first one at the bow. In this case, there's nobody the first. So that is the real one. The right-hand side is a bit faster. And now you see the right-hand side, red one, will be the first one. So that's an A-B test. I have seen that the B version, the right-hand version, is the better version. So that's the better side for me sailing. That's the better side for starting. I will win this race. Great. But also, the blue one knows that, so I don't want him to win again. And I do something like that. Slow down in the last part and giving false information. And that's also something very common in A-B tests, that you can manipulate the values, the data sets you have, by just, if you have not a big enough sample, it was changed by just one accident, by date, by weather, by product selection, something like that. To do this with many, many boats, something looks like this. This is just an example. This is the biggest regatta in worldwide, 1,000 boats for children up to 14 years, sailing at Lake Garda, 1,000 children. Easter, it's 12 degrees warm, and it's the same condition as my photo, so they are getting warm, wet, as we are. And here you can see they're sailing both directions, and in the top mark you can see who wins the race, who's the first one. And yes, for me as a sailor, it's very impressive to see those small children sailing those conditions and seeing so lot of people doing this. That's great stuff. And thank you for the video for Emilio Santinelli from Fragella Vella Riva, who has given it. That's really nice shots. Okay, so why do we A/B tests? Why do we want to do an A/B test? Simple, we want to find a better solution for our website. Or we want to verify the current solution so that we already have the best one. And let's get to an example. We want to find a better solution for our newsletter subscription. And I've brought you a website. Since I don't have Photoshop, I have to code this in HTML. That was out of one of our style guides, an awesome website. And we've got one subscription newsletter. That was, I've taken 3 days to code this. No, just kidding. So that's our website, and we want to improve the newsletter subscriptions. So we always start an A/B test with a hypothesis, an idea what should be better. That's, you have to formulate this, because only by verifying against the hypothesis you know if your A/B test was successful. And our hypothesis was, get free information will generate more clicks on the button. So we do another version of the website, and we now have two versions of the website. And what we now do is, we ask 2,000 visitors which version they prefer. And we do this without asking them. So a person who is taking part of an A/B test does not know that he or she is in an A/B test. That's very crucial, because only on that you can track the behavior. So we have got 2,000 visitors. We do a random generator, we put 50% on this version, 50% on the right-hand version, and yes, we count the visitors on each page, and we count the number on clicks of the newsletter, on the newsletter. And then we put in the statistics. So on the left-hand side, we had 1,000 page impressions, 250 clicks on the button, so it's for every user 25% probability to click on the button. 75% of persons think, oh, this website is boring, go away, go to Google, don't do anything on this website. So that's the two things a user can do on this page. He either can click or he can leave. On the right-hand side, we have also 1,000 page impressions, 310 clicks on the button, 31% probability, and yes, that's the better version. So we can also do this with non-even distribution. So on this idea is 75% on the left-hand side, 25% on the right-hand side, and you just do accordingly the math. So that's percentage calculation. That's easy. Excel can do this for you. But in both cases, we know the right version is the better version. So this is our winner. Hey, we can go to a party, we've done a good job, we have increased the clicks on the button, that's fine. But wait, we have installed the new website and something is going totally wrong. We are getting less subscriptions. Why that? So let's go through the whole step. We have got the awesome website, we get click on the button, get free information. We have got a website, subscribe to our newsletter, so I have to put into my name, my email. I have to click on the subscribe button, I get a confirmation mail and get a thank you mail, and that's the complete process. So that's the process we have. And on each stage of the process, I've got the user has got the possibility to abandon the process. He could not click on the button, he could not complete the form, he could not click on the email address, or the stuff is not working on the confirm page, he could also go back. And what now happened is that we tricked the user. We said, get free information. The user clicks on get free information, does not think it's a newsletter, and sees the newsletter registration form and abandons. That's what's happening in this example. And that's something which we learned very, very fast, that we have to take the last touch point for our comparison. So the goal is not to get people on the form page. The goal is to get confirmations. And that's the thing we have to measure. We have to measure the last touch point. Here is a newsletter confirmation. In a shop, it's always the sale. Our goal is for a shop to increase the sale. For those sites, it's a confirmation page. For marketing sites, the goal could be that the more visitors are seeing the product page. For a newsletter page, the more people are reading the newsletter. So that's one very crucial thing. That's one of the lessons we have learned really fast. always use the last touch point for the optimization as your goal. I've got all lessons learned on the last slide, so you don't have to write down, and I will publish the slides later on. Let's go to a real-world example, where we can also see how we used statistics. I've taken the typo3.com website as example. And if I look at the website, yeah, it scrolls down. So how many links are on this website? Any estimation? 50. It's 50 links on this website page. So the user has 51 possibilities to interact. There's always the one close the browser or go away. So the basic math we have done in the first example are getting a bit more complicated. Now what I want to do is I want to optimize this button, more about typo3. And what I do, it's the same, I optimize the button, I sample the data for each user interaction and analyze the distribution of data sets for each variant. So we have got a web page, we've got 50 links on it, we've got 51 possibilities, and I just write down how many people in percentage are clicking each link for the normal version. And I do the same for the new version. So I've got a probability that one link is clicked for each link on the website. So that looks like this. We've got the control version, the normal version, and we see the link one is clicked somewhere between 20, link two somewhere between 25 times, and all the stuff, so 50, 75 is nearly 100. So that's a normal distribution of links, how much they are clicked on the web page by an average user. And that's my variant version and test version. And I see on the test version, there are more clicks. So you can see that it's from 50 to somewhere to 70 grown up. So I see there's a difference in click distribution by just changing the links. But do I have here a result? Having a look at this chart, who thinks I've got a clear result that the version B is better? Okay, that's fine. Nobody. That's good. Because, we have to take in advantage, we have to take in account the sample size and significantly. So we have a distribution of possibilities, and we have to take care if the change we hear is in a normal random set, or is it just the normal. And I give you an example where it might be a bit clearer. You've got a dice. I've got some dice here. Yep. Just roll it a bit. One of those dice is not even. So that one of the dice is one who somebody wants to trick you in a game, gambling game, and the three is coming more often than in the other times. How can I find out that one of those dimes is a fake dime, is doing not the same? What should I do? Okay, I take both dimes and I roll them many, many times. And a normal dime, I should have the same distribution for every number, and a non-normal dime, I should have a different distribution. How much times I have to roll them to figure out something like that? 6 times? It's a bit, it depends on how much the unnormal distribution is, but example shows that it should be somewhere around 60 rows. And if you see the observation, that's an example, an actual example, you see there's a not clear distribution. But to be sure that this clear distribution is significantly correct, you should use a significance calculator. It's a calculator where you put in the number of test cases you have done, the number of results, and then it calculates if this result is significantly different or incorrect or changed. And that's where the chi-square calculation comes in. That's include just Google significance calculator, put in your data and you get some results and they tell you, okay, this data is significantly changed from the normal set or is different from this. So what you have to keep in mind is that you always have a random distribution of values in your clicks on the website. It's not the same. You have got always a difference. People are not clicking the same, and so the you can't compare just two clicks. You have to compare quite a lot of clicks to get an idea what is normal, what's a change. And you must use a significance calculator to verify your tests. So that was lesson learned. And if you're going to A/B test, you should not trust your feeling about the result. You have to calculate every time if this is a significant, relevant value you've got, or if it's just a feeling, or if it's not significantly. We have taken the dimes. You need about 60 rolls. You've got 6 possibilities. Let's have a look on the real-world website where we really currently working on it. That's a customer website. And as it's a customer website and it's done with a CMS, you can see how many products are in there. It's amazing how many products you can put on the web page. And what we want to do is we want to optimize this area here on the top. And before optimizing, we start to have a look in the data sets. How many people in the normal distribution are clicking on this element? I can have this idea how many people in a normal distribution can click on it by Google Analytics. I just see how many people are clicking on this link, get a percentage value, and got an idea. So Google Analytics tells me that 0.3% of all users click on this element. And if I take an account that in a normal online shop I have got a conversion rate between 5 to 10% somewhere, I use 5%, and calculate the percentage of people who click on this and buy this product. So that's 0.015% of people seeing this web page, clicking on this product and buying it. And that's an idea for me how many times this page I have to show people and also show a modification page to get an idea if I have changed something relevant. And our guess for, we have done similar tests, that I would need more than 1 million page views of this page to change this element, because there are so many links on it. We have run similar tests, so we need at most times in normal web pages a really, really big data set to see a variance in the distribution. So to calculate significance, lots of data sets are needed. And yes, some people tell me, and that if you go to the web and research all the stuff, can I run a test only with a few visitors? And some people say, okay, you can optimize it. You can just go for one part of the web page. And my personal opinion is, no, you can't. You don't have the amount of data to do this, and the time and the amount of time and money you need to set up a B test for such few visitors is better spent in other areas of the web page. For example, to buy AdWords or something like that to get more people on your web page and then run the A/B test. But the main question is now, how can I check that I will have enough samples? So what can I do in beforehand to find out if I really can run an A/B test? And that's, run an AA test. So really set up both systems, set up a test between the same versions, and after a while, if they not differ, you have got enough samples to say that's the same. And you would also have the same number of samples to say if they are different. So that's a very good way to find out if I would get enough samples for running really a B test. And if you have ever run an AA test, normally you would say, okay, it's always the same and all the stuff. it would be really interesting to watch the numbers and see how these numbers differs and go to the same number and how long it takes, because so many interactions with people, with users on the web page are happening, that it's really really interesting to see that beginning that quite difference is really, really great, and after really a time the difference is the same, and that takes a really long time. So if you're in doubt, you run an AA test first to check if you will get enough samples. Yes, another test we have done. We have been running the web page heimwerker.de, that is one of the biggest DIY pages in Germany. And we want this page is a bit financed by having affiliate links. So we display products, we tell something about products, and if you click on this button, the user is redirected to Amazon, to other shops, and if the user buys, we get a bit of the money back. And yeah, we said, okay, we have got quite a lot of people on those pages, but the turnover at Amazon and all the other stuff is not very good. And yes, we had the hypothesis that if we embed the shop name in the button, we build a bit more trust and the people would click more on the button. And then a team took this, went away and said, okay, we will run the A-B test. And what they did, they rolled out that change only on a small set of pages and compared it by week turnover and presented the data to me. And that's what I did. let's see what's wrong. So if you roll out this change only on a small set of pages, your sample sizes, that's so little that you can't do a decision. And if you compare it by week turnover, you have got, in this case, we had got two problems. One week was with an additional bank holiday. So on a bank holidays, we don't have that much click. It's a normal day, so that's also a difference. And it was on gardening products, and that was one week with sun, and the other week was rain. So it was nobody was looking at the gardening products on the rain week. So that was also the second and the third problem at this case. So the you should not do this, and you could not ever compare an A-B test by a week comparison, or by a day comparison, or by a number or by hour comparison. That it's not possible. You have to do it in the same time. So that was my first learning. I should always introduce marketing into the concept of A-B tests and the basic maths, because otherwise they do something like that and we don't have any clear results. And take the normal variance of visits and page impressions and turnover in account. You have every time you have a variance, depending on the weather, depending on the day, depending on football games, depending on everything, so there's a normal variance, and that's something you have to take into account, and it must be always an A-B test at the same time. Another one. We called it stars or no stars. We've got a product display, and we know we have got the user ratings available, and our hypothesis was, if you display the ratings, so that's a very good product, the sales will increase. So what we did an A-B test. We showed the stars at any time. And as they were curious about the ratings of the products, we said, okay, the B version was show the stars only when we have got 4 or 5 stars. Don't show the stars for products which are badly rated. And what was the result? Comparing those two versions, B was significantly better, but after installing this, we did not see any change in the overall numbers of the shop, so we thought about maybe something, it's not fine. And lessons learned from this, always use the status quo as a control variant. Click too fast. Always use the status quo as control variant. So you always must have one version which is not changed as a control to the other version. So we did the A-B test again with three versions. A was status quo, B stars at any time, C stars only when 4 and more. We run that for more than 2.4 million web pages to see any difference in it. Always a star was significantly less turnover. So it turns out showing a bad rating for a product will decrease the overall sales, not from this product, but the overall sales of the shop. And A and C were not significantly different. And so no stars and showing only 4 and 5 stars are almost the same, that the same data. And we decided for C, so we put in the stars for 4 and 5, and the reason is it looks nicer. So not all tests have a result, so you have to take still a best guess what you would judge, what would be the next one. And also you should accept failure. Negative results could lead you to another area of the web page, or could show you that you're already on the right path. You could not optimize this by an A-B test. You must have different approach, more extreme approaches, more changes. Another test. Who of you knows PayPal Express? If you are in payment, PayPal Express, difference to normal PayPal. PayPal Express is, I call it a shortcut in the checkout. Because on the checkout page, you click on PayPal Express, enter your data at PayPal Express, and then you get the thank you page. You won't enter anything on the web page. And that was a test which was run with PayPal. They wanted to convince us. And yes, to add here the PayPal Express button. So we built up a version with PayPal Express and without PayPal Express and did run an A-B test. No, not we did run an A-B test. PayPal did run an A-B test on this data. And we also did an A-B test to control them, control their data, what's the difference. Because I don't trust any payment provider, so I want to have my own numbers. And that's the results. We can skip the first one, that was the sample stuff. On the basket page, that's the conversion rate increasement just by adding the button PayPal Express on the basket page. And these are the differences, adding the PayPal logos on the normal checkout in the web page. And the result for this calculation was that we can gain 1.72% more conversion rate in the basket process by using PayPal Express. That's wrong. Either the user uses this button or uses the normal checkout, so we can't add this to others. And what was more interesting, by using this button, we were losing people in other payments. We are losing people in cheaper payments. For example, this company really likes to have payment by invoice because they can handle this by themselves. They have really good data set. They don't have losses on the invoice, and that's the best way for them to handle it. They don't have to pay for PayPal. And by using this button, we increased the conversion rate a bit, but we lost so many people not using invoice that the money-wise, it was not a good decision. So, A-B test must reflect your business case. So the business case is that I want to have a good payment and also don't want to spend too much money to any PayPal or other payment systems. And always use your significance calculator, not the one who wants to test you. So always use the same significance calculator. That's one of the stuff we really learned on this one. But let's see what could be the future of A-B tests. We've got, again, this product. And the hypothesis is, if I put the best products there, it would increase my sales. So what should I do? OK, I would do an A version with this product and a B version with another product. That's normal. And that's normally done by a category manager. And that's how he does. He's doing a test, comparing the data, doing the next test, again, again, again. They have the best product selection. So that sounds good. We have got a bit better conversion, better turnover. But what's the real world? It's we do a setup, we do a test, then the category manager must read results, research new products, then test, then it's weekend, then he's on a manufacturer meeting, then it's again weekend, then we run the next test, and then it's the holidays. So on the blue areas, nobody is taking care of the data. Nobody is optimizing the stuff, and we are on a baseline. We don't change it, we don't increase it, which is not really nice for a shop because you always want to increase the turnover, you always want increased sales. So the best way would be to have a straight line which is going up and up and up and increasing your sales. So either I could have one person stand by who's just doing the A/B test permanently, day and night, and as soon as he's got significant data sets, changes the products and increases, increases, increases. So I have to build up many people in category management to work them 24 hours, 7 days a week. Or I try to use an automatic selection via recommendation engine. And the recommendation engine does exactly what I've told you. Just changes one product, do an A/B test until there's a significance, changes again, 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 again. And by the time it's really that great, which is increases the products and increases the sales and optimize your product selection. And we have A/B tested that. So we have done the normal version and the automatic version via a recommendation engine. And we saw a dramatic increase in sales and with less work on the category side. So at this area, if possible, use a recommendation engine for contents. So you could not only use this on products, you can use it also on contents. You can, in web pages with contents, your goal, your last touch point is the display of an article. Your goal for a newspaper site is that somebody reads the web page, the newspaper page, and sees the advertisements. Also, the goal on a newspaper site could be that somebody clicks on the advertisement. You can use this as goal for recommendation engines to optimize the data, to optimize your display of the contents to gain more turnover, to gain more visits, or to gain more turnover in products. And if you've got enough visits on the web page and have got a proper recommendation engine, the results are great, are really great, and you can go on and on and on, optimize it automatically. You just have to take care about the content and the data for the recommendation engine. Putting all together, I've got the one slide with all results. That's quite, I don't know if you can read it in the back, but I will publish the slides, and also it's videotaped. So that's the test, the lessons we have learned on running the A/B test for about 5 years now. And the main stuff is it's getting always back to give a clear introduction to people who want to run an A/B test, to give an introduction to customers that there's math involved, that you have to give away your feelings, you just trust the numbers, and give them idea how something like that works. And as soon as a customer or a marketeer or somebody else wanted to run an A/B test, has understood this, these are really great methods to run A/B tests. And if somebody asked me about a tool to use for A/B test, I could not give a recommendation because every example I've shown you is problematic with one or the other tools. So you have to choose the tool or the way you measure the A/B test by the test you're currently running and use one of those tools. Yes? Questions?
So in the example you showed,
danke.
In the example you showed, the position of the product was this also altered? Or did you only check for the first position.
In this case, we just test for the first position. We wanted to optimize the first position. But you can go through all products in such a box and alter this. But it's easier to change one thing on the web page, not several things. Because if you change several things, you are multiplying the distribution by the amount of changes you have. So in that case, I've shown you where I guessed it was 1 million of page views we need. If there's another change on this web page, I think we need more than 2 million or 2.5 million, and that increases the amount of data sets you need. And if you've got a website, you can do this fine. If you don't have a website like this, you should not do this. The goal is to run the test in the smallest amount of time. So I could also run the free test on the page for 3 months, but that would change too much during this time. I want to do this in 3 days. Or 1 day or 1 hour, as Google does.
Anybody else?
Yeah.
I have a question to the slide with the holidays and the A/B testing.
Yes.
So. This thing was about the test running over all the 3 weeks.
The test was run, A was week 41, yes. B was week 42, for example.
Okay. So how do you take into account then when you do an A-B test and it turns out test number B is produces much better results, and then you change another set, so you get variant C. So do you take into account that variant B is the new A?
If you after an A-B test, you get a clear result.
Yeah.
And you can say, okay, I've got a result which is better, and I try to start from this result to do the next A-B test. So I take B as the new control variant and put a new C on it. That would be either the possibility, yeah, or... I want to be sure I can also use a test with free stats. That depends a bit on the number of visits you have and the way you want to go on. But the normal way is to go on B and take another test on top.
Yeah, thank you. I see you really like the numbers.
it's really numbers because you don't it's no feeling anymore. You have clear numbers and just trust them.
Anybody else?
Oh.
We'll get you to sports today.
So has your company designed a significance calculator, or
you just Google Google significance calculator?
Okay.
You will get 40 versions of it,
okay,
and always use the same one.
Mm.
So we've taken a JavaScript significance calculator, put it to our intranet or to the customer's intranet, and always using the same one.
Mm.
Don't change it, because then you can't compare anything.
Mm. Thanks.
There are 3 different ways to calculate significance. The C-square I've showed you is one, the other one is a p-test, and there's a third one, I don't remember it, but they're doing almost the same. You should always use the same one. And if in Germany, take care about American versions with point and comma.
Anybody else?
We got time.
Another coffee break? All right then. Thank you very much, Ingo.